My name is Mira Kara. I'm currently a postdoc at Stanford Computer Science. This work is part of one of the last works I did in my PhD with my advisor, Gil Bareket from the Technion. And it talks about improved upper bounds on the growth constants of polyominoes and polycubes. So first off, I will start by defining a polyomino. So a polyomino is an edge-connected set of squares. The most famous examples probably of polyominoes are the Tetris pieces, which are polyominoes with four squares. Polycubes are the higher dimensional generalization of polyominoes. So a d-dimensional polycube is a facet-connected set of d-dimensional cubes. For example, here we can see a set of three-dimensional polycubes. One of the central questions in combinatorics deals with enumerating the number of d-dimensional polycubes that have n cubes or have size n, which are distinct up to translations. This number still remains unknown up to this day for any dimension d. And a lot of work has focused on computing the value lambda d, which denotes the quotient as n approaches infinity of ad of n plus 1 over ad of n, which in other words is called the growth constant of polycubes. Even in two and three dimensions, this growth constant remains unknown, and there has been a lot of work trying to estimate this value. So our work deals with improving the upper bound on this on these values. So we can see on the right, in two dimensions, the best known lower and upper bounds are roughly four in a lower bound and an upper bound of 4.65. In three dimensions, the gap is much larger. And in higher dimensions, for a general D, we have 2D minus 1 times E. In this work, we improve the upper bound, slightly improve the upper bound in two dimensions, and significantly improve it in three dimensions. And we also improve the upper bound for a general D by an additive factor of E. Let me briefly describe the strategy. So the strategy for improving the upper bound on the number of polycubes follows the idea of mapping or defining an injection from polycubes to strings, and then counting the those strings, and from that a number produce an upper bound of the number of polycubes. The first method was given in 1967 by Eden, and the idea of Eden was to encode the polycube in a way that he did that for polyominoes. So we start at some at the lowest and leftmost cell in the polyomino. And for each cell, since the polyomino has to be connected, we can ignore one direction where we come to this square. And then we only encode the status of the remaining three neighbors of the polyomino. So the algorithm he gave is really simple because it's a simple BFS traversal of the cell adjacency graph of the polyomino. So it really works exactly as a BFS. It has a queue for the cells. And the only difference is that at each step, we also construct, we add to the string we can see on the left, three bits that describe whether the cell belongs to the polyomino or not. So up to now, we have 011, 011. The third cell now adds 0 because this cell 5 has already been discovered. And then the next two are non-occupied, so we add 000 to the string, and so on. So this defines an injection from a polyomino of size n into a binary string that has n minus 1 ones. And the reason it has n minus 1 ones is that each cell in the BFS traversal can be discovered only once. And the rest are 2d minus 2 times n zeros. So overall, this gives us this nice binomial coefficient that says ad of n, the number of polyominoes, is smaller than this binomial coefficient. And I'm not going to show the analysis, you can refer to the paper, but using Stirling's formula, it's not hard to show that lambda d is smaller than 2d minus 1 times e. For two dimensions, this gives us 6.75, and for three dimensions, this gives us the best, before our work, this was the best known upper bound on lambda 3. Another way to look at Eden's construction is a way that as we traverse the cell adjacency graph of the polyomino, we assign each cell a building block. And there are 8 building blocks because we are encoding the status of 3 neighbors of the cell. So it's either empty or occupied, since so that's that equals 2 to the 3, which equals 8 options. So it's another way to look at this mapping is a mapping into strings over the alphabet E1 to E8 to the N, because we have N cells. Following Eden's work, Kleiner and Rivest in 1973 enhanced the construction, and they noticed that encoding 3 neighbors is unnecessary, and we can use fewer building blocks. The idea is that as we traverse the BF, as we traverse the graph in the BFS traversal, we don't need to encode 3 statuses for the neighbors. We only need to encode 2 neighbors, and the reason this happens is because at each step around the current cell, there are 4 cells around it that we can see in green here that we know their status. So we can ignore completely, and we don't need to encode their status. The only remaining cells that we have to encode are the one on the top and the one on the right. For these ones, we will exhaust all the options. So the first option is that both of them don't belong to the polyomino, and that's a simple thing to encode. The other option is that the one on the top does not belong to the polyomino, but the one on the right does belong to the polyomino. Now, for the construction to work, we have to show that the cell on the right also have 4 cells in the shape of L around it that we can ignore while we encode the status of its neighbors. And as you can see here, this L shape is contains cells that we know already their status, and we can ignore during the traversal. The next option is when the top cell and the right cell do belong to the polyomino. And now again, we show, okay, this L shape here, we know the status of all the cells. And since we assigned this cell number 1, so it is entered to the BFS queue before cell number 2. So this cell will explore this neighbor and this neighbor. It will encode their status. And then when we reach this cell will be known already. So we have an L neighborhood for this cell. And the construction works. The only problematic case that we get is when the cell to the right does not belong to the polyomino, and the cell to the top does belong to the polyomino. What happens here is that we cannot find any L neighborhood of known cells. I hope you can see this from the illustration, but we cannot find such one. To overcome this problem, there's a very simple trick. Okay, we say, let's explore what happens to the corner cell. So the corner cell might be occupied or not occupied. If it's not occupied, then we have this L neighborhood and we can proceed with the construction. If it is occupied, then we have the L neighborhood, but now we have that this cell has an L neighborhood. So if we enter this cell first to the queue, it will discover the status of this cell, and now the corner cell has a known L neighborhood. And this, in fact, gives us a new construction from polyominoes of size n into sequences of building blocks, but now we have fewer building blocks. We only have 5 building blocks, and so we map the polyomino into an alphabet, into strings over an alphabet of size 5 to the n, because we have n cell and squares. And this already improves the upper bound that we have before. If you recall, it was 6.75. Now it already is reduced to 5. What is interesting to note here is that this set of building blocks cannot be reduced further, because we proved that lambda 2 is greater than 4. So we cannot construct a more compact cell of building blocks. Okay, in this work, one of the first questions we wanted to answer was, can we extend this construction, this really nice construction that Kleiner and Rivest gave in 2D, to higher dimensions? And the answer was that we can do that. And we started off with 3 dimensions. So the simple thing about 3-dimensional cubes is that a three-dimensional cube is a two-dimensional square that was extruded in the third dimension. So if you look at our cube, it's the center cube here. And what we're looking at is the cell adjacency graph of the three-dimensional cubic lattice. And so what happens here is that when we go from two dimensions to three dimensions, this new dimension here, the cube gains two new neighbors, one in the negative x3 direction and one in the positive x3 direction. And so what we notice is that we can use the building blocks that Klarner and Rivest gave for two dimensions to encode the neighborhood of the three-dimensional cube. So the first option, we focus on the two dimensions x1 and x2, and we say the first option is encoded by this building block, which means that the cell on the right and the cell on top do not belong to the polyomino. And for the remaining new neighbors of this cube, we simply encode all of the configurations that they can have. So they have 2 to the 2 equals 4 configurations. The first one is that they both don't belong to the polycube, and so on. In total, we have 4. The other thing we had to build was a new definition of a neighborhood that we can ignore. So in 2D, you remember this was an L shape. In 3D, it's a new shape that we define. It's an L shape that intersects some plus sign. And what we need to show is that for every cell that belongs to the polyomino, to the polycube, sorry, and is added to the queue, this neighborhood can be ignored. And we do show that in our construction, and I refer you to the paper in case you want to see the full analysis. But we follow this for each of the building blocks in two dimensions, and the construction magically works. The only problem happens when, in the same case in two dimensions, when the cell to the right does not belong to the polycube and the cell to the top does belong to the polycube. In this case, we need one more building block. It's not enough to have 4. It turns out we have to have 5 for the same reason this happened in 2D. So what we end up with is that Eden's method gave us 32 building blocks for three-dimensional polycubes, while our construction now gives almost half the number, only 17 building blocks. And I will not cover this here for shortage of time, but we show in the paper that this construction works similarly for higher values of for any d greater than 3. And so we claimed that we improved the upper bound to these values. So far I only showed you how we improved the upper bound on lambda 2 to 5. So how do we obtain these new improved results? So turns out that this upper bound of 5 to the n is pretty rough because not all of these 5 to the n strings may encode valid polycubes. So for example, this string that has only L1s does not correspond to any valid polyomino. And similarly, a string that only contains L5s does not correspond to any valid polyomino of size n. The intuition behind this is that a polyomino of size n may have at most n over 3 occurrences of this letter L5, because L5 adds 3 cells at a time to the, sorry, adds 2 cells at a time to the polyomino. So this brings us to the conclusion that not all of the building blocks are equal. And to treat this problem, we assign each building block a weight. And this is very similar in fashion to what Klarner and Rivest did in dimensions. So x and y are variables. And the weight we assign is x to the a, y to the a, where a is the number of cells in the building blocks in the building block minus 1. And b is the number of black cells in the building block. So recall that each element in the building block, each building block has this root black cell here. And the nice thing is that we define the weight of a sequence of building blocks to be x times the multiplication of the weight of all of the building blocks in the sequence. I'm going over this maybe a bit fast, but I refer you to the paper in case you want to know more details. But the nice fact here is that a polyomino we can show is mapped to a sequence of weight x to the n, y to the n. So when it's the BFS traversal and we assign each cell one of the elements L1 through L5, and we compute the weight of the sequence the way we defined it here, it is not hard to see that the weight of the sequence that we get is x to the n, y to the n. And this is this holds also for all of the dimensions. And so what we do is we look at the two variable generating function over x and y, and by looking at all of the sequences of building blocks from k equals 0 to infinity, such that and we sum the weights of all the sequences that have length k for each k. What we get at the end is that we get this expression right here, and what's inside these brackets here is simply the sum of the weights of the building blocks. So for the building blocks in 2D, that's the weight that we get. For the building blocks in 3D, that's the weight we get, and so forth. For the building blocks in D dimensions, that's the number we get. I hope you can see there's a very nice pattern that's repeated here. And so I'm not going to show how we prove it for D dimensions because it's a bit elaborate, but for two dimensions, the idea is that we want to find the coefficient of x to the n, y to the n, because that's what polyominoes map to. And so to compute this coefficient in this two variable generating function, we need to compute the coefficient of x to the n minus 1 in the expression right here, because y to the n appears only here, and we have a factor of x here. So we only need to find the coefficient of x to the n minus 1 in this expression. And to do that, we use the multinomial theorem. Again, it's only practical details here, but when we open the brackets, we get this number. We require that I1 plus 2i2 equal n minus 1. And while we simplify this, we get this number here, which is, in fact, 4.83. That's an upper bound on lambda 2. The same thing, we follow the same approach. We take this expression right here, and we look for the coefficient of x to the n minus 1. And we get this number right here, which is roughly 10. There is a more delicate analysis in the paper that gives the upper bound that we claim, which is roughly 9.7. That's the proof for higher dimensions for any D. I'm not going to get into it because it's too technical. I refer you to Lieber. I'm going to finish by saying, I hope I gave a brief overview of how we obtained these bounds. These bounds can be further improved by an iterative algorithm that builds greater sets of building blocks. While we increase the sets of building blocks, we show that we increase the upper bound. And so we do this for two dimensions and three dimensions, and we get computer-assisted computer-assisted proofs for the two upper bounds that we see here. And so to conclude with the open problems that we have, major ones is to narrow the gap between the upper and lower bounds. In D dimensions, we almost closed the bound because the estimated value is 2D minus 3E, and we show 2D minus 2E. So we only have a factor of E to close the gap. And one question that is interesting to answer is, can we construct more compact building blocks for D greater equal than 3? So we answered that in two dimensions, it's impossible. The question is, in three dimensions, can we reduce the number of building blocks from 17 to a smaller number? And can we do that to higher dimensions? And that's it for me. I think my time is up.